Thank you very much. So, why build hands for robots? Let's start there. I started out 30 years ago being fascinated by the idea of doing AI for robots, but there weren't any robots to do AI for. So rather than go and build AI corporations, I got involved in trying to build and debug and make robots work. And we started out actually trying to build things that walked on two legs, because we felt if a robot was going to be useful, it would have to be able to wander around our environment. Turns out that yes, in theory that's the case, but in practice, honestly, if you want something to walk around your environment, hire a person. We're great at it. What you really want robots to do is tasks that we find boring, dull, dangerous, repetitive, and we're not actually that good at it. And there's a fantastic figure about this. Humans get things right 99% of the time when they do a repetitive task, which means that 1% of the time, humans get it wrong. And if you go and look at any production line, you'll see humans doing complicated assembly tasks, fitting tasks, and fixturing tasks, where they're checked all the way through by sensors and mechanisms to make sure that they didn't make that 1% error. Because in a day, if you do something 5,000 times, you're going to make that error 50 times. And you have to have systems in place to check it. So we thought, let's build hands for robots, and then the robots can have the same capability of interacting with the world that we do. And that, we figured, was kind of a really interesting and important step. So our kind of vision as a company is to do exactly this, to be the people you go to when you say, you know what, I need a robot to interact with something. It's got to pick it up, it's got to move it around, it's got to put it down somewhere. What am I going to do? Well, if I'm a production engineer and I'm building a production line and I want to hold a part in place, there's a German company I just go to, Schunk. They're fantastic, they're brilliant. They're mechanical engineers and they make things all day, every day, lovely shiny pieces of steel that grip things and hold them. And that's all they do. They don't know whether they've held it, they don't adapt to it, they don't understand what they're holding. They don't have any intelligence, they're not smart. And we figured that the interesting nexus where robotics adds value to everybody is where we add smart into mechanical engineering tasks. We make machines that can think about the world they're interacting with and do something differently. They can react, they can cope, they can adapt. And that's grasping and manipulation rather than just gripping. So, I mean, the human hand is an amazing thing. We still don't completely understand some of the mechanisms that make it work. The base of the thumb joint, there's a standing joke that if you can get three anatomy professors in a room together, ask them how the base of the thumb works and watch them fight, because they'll disagree. We're just not quite sure. There are joints in there that you cannot replicate mechanically because they're just floating joints that aren't coupled and rely on tendons to hold them in place. So when we try and build copies of that in a robot, we have to use different methods and different technologies. And that's what we've been doing. We've been building hands that are human-like hands, and we've sold them to space agencies, we've sold them to researchers. We like to joke that our customer always has the same first name. They're always called Professor. And the reason for that is when we started building hands, it was really, really hard to build them, so no one had them. We think there are three other organizations in the world that had built a robot hand at the time we built our first one, and all of them had built one that was used for one piece of R&D and then got put on the shelf. We built them because we were engineering people. We built them so they worked because we wanted to use them. And we found that we had people coming in the door and saying, I want to use that because I want to work out what I can do with a hand for a robot, how I can use that to do something, how I can make it work. And over 20 years, we've built a really deep pool of expertise and connections around basically everyone in the world who wants to get robots to pick things up well. And that really sounds like a simple thing, doesn't it? And that's because as a primate, that's something we just do. We don't even think about picking things up. We don't think about interacting with objects and holding them because that's what a large part of our cortex is devoted to. There's an old story that when von Neumann and his colleagues first started working on artificial intelligence, they had a conference in 1953, I think, and they decided at the conference that it was quite important to solve this vision thing, and they'd get some people to work on it, and they work out how to get computers to see and understand the world. And so they sent two PhD students off for 6 months because they figured that was about the size of the problem. It's now 60-something years later, and we now have computers that can see things in the world reliably enough that we're starting to think about using them for things like driving, for facial recognition, for object recognition. But that's a very, very long haul. When it comes to tasks that humans think are easy, we've always found that really, really hard to replicate in machines. Tasks that humans think are hard, it turns out computers are great at and it's easy to do, like chess, that's an easy one for a computer. But tasks that we think are easy, gripping, grasping, holding, interacting with objects, really, really challenging. So that's what we've been focused on. We build these very, very high-end robots. This is a human-like hand. It's got all the capability of the human hand. Put that on a robot, you should, in theory, be able to do anything with it. And I say in theory because, as we all know, the difference between theory and practice is that, in theory, there is no difference between theory and practice. And in robotics, that's the problem we run up against all the time. The real world is harsh and unforgiving and does not care what your beautiful algorithms say should be true. The real world only cares about what actually just happened, and that tends to involve dirt and fuss and grime and noise and error. So we build this, our colleagues work with us to use this to understand how to do tasks and how to make robots capable of doing things. And we've done some amazing stuff with this. A couple of years ago, we built a robot that could cook exactly like a chef. You walk into the room, you say, robot, cook me dinner, it cooks you dinner. Takes it half an hour, does an absolutely fantastic crab bisque. Would you want a crab bisque every day? No, we'd need to cook 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 different dishes to be useful, and we'd have to be trained to do that, but the core concept is there. So with this, we can replicate anything a human can do. But that's not actually useful yet, because we can't necessarily do it cost-effectively. And those of you who work in manufacturing will almost certainly have a number like £36,000 per shift per year, which is what it costs a company in Coventry to employ somebody whose job is picking up metal parts and giving them to a robot. And that's what they do all day, every day. And very occasionally they put the wrong part in and the robot breaks the welding jig and they have to scrap a whole lot of stuff and repair and rework and so on. But we have a person there, a highly skilled human being, really, really understands manufacturing tasks, and all they're doing is picking up bits of metal plate and giving them to a robot. That doesn't seem like an efficient use of a human's time, and for the company, it's not necessarily cost-effective. It's costing them £36,000 fully loaded per shift per year to do that. So that's an interesting price point, because that means that if I can build a robot that can run for two shifts a year, for under £70,000, I can get CapEx payback in the first year. And that's pretty easy sale to a production manager. So we went and we looked at what we needed to do to move from this space at the top where we have amazing robot hands that can do huge numbers of tasks and are really flexible and dexterous and agile. And there's stuff up there from NASA and from us, and that stuff is fantastic for research. And then down at the bottom, if you actually go out and want to put gripping on a robot and grasping on a robot, you'll end up with something that either just does that and clamps and holds something, which is fantastic, if you know exactly what you're handling. So if I go into one of Michael's plants and I say, I'm going to pick up those turbine blades, that's fine. We can get a nice gripper that will hold the turbine blade by the fixture on the end and pick it up every time perfectly. And that's wonderful. Production engineers love that. But if he's got 10 different turbine blades coming into the plant because we're looking at some options around those blades, we don't know which one we're going to work with, do I have 10 different grippers? Well, yeah, I can do that and I can change them over, but then I've got to make sure that all of them work and I've got to make sure I'm using the right one. And what then happens if we've got 100 or 1,000 different parts coming in? Well, sure, there are various products you can see at the bottom there, what we call adaptive grippers. So they have flexibility, but they implement that in their mechanism. They're sprung, they're compliant, they're soft. They can grasp various things, but you don't know how well they're doing it, and you can't control how well you're doing it. And I know that if you pick up a turbine blade like that and you don't hold it correctly and you drop it, there's going to be a very, very unhappy quality assurance guy coming up and going, you can't do that. You've just destroyed the crystalline structure of the blade. We now have to throw it away. So we figured, what goes in that gap? What's the difference between a really dexterous thing like a human and a standard industrial gripper or grasping solution? And we had some... We've always been very plugged into the research community. I think we've now done 10 European collaborations and 7 or 8 Innovate UK collaborations. We're really, really big on doing collaborative R&D. And in one of our projects, we got the opportunity to go away and redefine how we built hands. And we came up with the idea of building something that did grasping rather than gripping, because we figured, actually, was it grasping rather than manipulation? So we figured manipulation is great. No one knows how to program it yet. One day we will, but it's still been 20 years and people still don't know how to program manipulation. However, grasping, that we can do. And this is what we're working on at the moment, which is a system that just grasps things and does it well and holds them. And that means that we can put that on an industrial platform, and if there's a part coming towards us and you have a 3D model of that part, and in modern manufacturing, if you don't have a digital twin of the part on the production line, people look at you like you're from the Stone Age. So, what do you mean you don't have a model of it? Yeah, we haven't got around to that yet. let's introduce you to Siemens, get the Industry 4.0 stuff in, then you'll have more. Right. So we can rely on people having models of their parts. If they've got so many parts that they don't have models, if you're Amazon, you've got this incredible long tail, you don't know what's in your warehouses. There, okay, we can use 3D scanning, 3D modeling to build up models, but if you give us a model of the part, we can work out how to hold it well, and how to hold it well in different ways from different orientations. That sounds like, why would you want to do that? Because it's sitting there on a shelf and I don't know how I can reach it. So I have to be able to reach it in a way that means I can pick it up and keep hold of it. And that primate intelligence, what we do without thinking about it, is something no one has yet done in robotics. So, where does that take us? What does that do? Well, with this kind of grasping concept, we see that we can take a whole set of tasks where currently we're wasting human intelligence on primate, using our primate abilities to do things. We're not using the higher cognitive functions that we have, we're just picking things up and putting them down again. There's a wide range of industrial tasks like that. And over the next 10 years, we think we're going to, we expect to see a massive impact on that, because if we don't, I'm not doing my job right. So we'll go into industry, we'll find these challenges and problems and say, look, here you have rework problems, you have scrap problems, you have efficiency problems, you have scaling problems, because you can't deliver enough high performance people to do that. And if you train the people to do it, honestly, they go out of their mind with boredom. They don't actually want to do that all day. So we can put in a robot that does that part of the task, it replaces the human, and then the human can go and do something more interesting and more useful. People say, but surely, you know, that means we're going to lose lots and lots of jobs. It's very interesting. Every time I talk to somebody in manufacturing, their question is not, how can I get rid of some people because I want to save money? Their question is, I can't get any more people. We're engaged with the skills pipeline, we're doing apprenticeships, we're doing technical degree courses, technical qualifications, we cannot get enough competent people in the front door of our factory. How can I free up some of my competent people to do more useful, higher value added tasks? So we think that's where the real impact of this technology is going to come. It's going to be taking people you already have, who know what you do, who know how you do it, and getting them to do higher value added tasks because the machines can do the simpler ones where you were using the people just because they had that ability. So, we're very, very big believers in working with the community, open innovation, in the whole concept. For those of you who still aren't doing open innovation, let me just rephrase it. Open innovation to me is about finding someone who cares about my problem so much more than I do that they set up a business to do it. And if I can find them, I can give them one of my problems and rely on them to go and solve it because they've got a commercial interest in doing so. And because they want to solve one of my problems, the odds are that some of their customers are going to want some of the things I do anyway, because frankly, we're operating in the same space. Our problems are adjacent, so our partners and customers and value chain are going to be adjacent. So if I can find people who want to solve my problems, then I've probably got great business partners to take my technology to market. And that's what we're doing. We don't build robot arms because we can buy those off hundreds of companies. We don't build tactile sensors because it turns out there are lots of people who run businesses that make fingertips for robot hands. You wouldn't have thought a niche like that would exist, but because it's a common problem across the industry, people set up in business to develop and do that. So we're working out various ways to take our technology forwards, and if you have a problem that looks a bit like grasping and gripping, please do come and talk to us because we think we may have ways to help address that. We may equally say, nah, go to Schunk, they have what you want, you can just buy it off the shelf from them, they're a great German engineering company. Or we'll say, yeah, we have something that they don't do and we think it will help you. So, thank you very much. I'm a minute ahead. Thank you, everyone.